last night as well.
Hello and welcome back there, Big Gunners. This is Josh Boyle, just helping out Dan do some commentating while we look for the superstar Jamie to come back. So we got Mick and Joel playing here. I think we got the names are around the wrong way on your screen. It is actually 3-1 to Joel. So Scary just broken off, nice spread. And he's put down a red ball, so we'll be looking at the out here. He's taking reds. And he's not happy with that at all. But it didn't leave too much, actually. So, Joel now on the yellows. I don't think the opener to the middle goes, so he's got the one up the top on the rail, which he won't like. Probably look to play a containing shot here if possible. This is quite a big plot to take on and out. So I believe here that we're possibly in the semi of the loser side of the draw. Obviously Rusty is already waiting in the final. So whoever has to play him and win twice, it's a big ask, but anything can happen with these guys. So Joel's just taking some time here because it is, as we say, not an easy opener. So it looks like the one to the middle does actually go. A bit difficult with these camera angles. Another Porsche. So we're not what you're used to with these kind of guys. Scary will be licking his lips at this out. Everything's reasonably open, and if you can get the angle on this one on the bottom here, I think you can have a real crack at this. Yeah, it looks fine. Just stunning for the one into the center. Just looking for those connecting balls. Just to make the out a little bit easier. So probably just take this one in the center. Most likely stun. And then the one nearest the black, you would think. So here he is. No, he's actually gone up the top. Get rid of those balls first. Maybe he's actually trying to get onto this one near the rail. This is only half problem ball, so he'll be just having another look at it, make sure he can get onto it after these two up the top. Not sure if he'll get on that better, but taking the ones at the top. A lot of the better players do tend to move down one end of the table to the other, so they're not moving the white ball too much. Scary's played quite well all weekend, smashed me up in one of the earlier rounds, so he'll be very confident today. So he's taking his reasonable problem ball off the rail, just stun off. Well, he's needed the angle on the bottom one, so he's just run through there. I mean, I look probably a little bit closer to the rail than he'd like, but he should be fine. Just seeing where he has to land off this bottom ball. Anywhere to the middle of the table on the right-hand side there should be fine. Oh, close to win off, and he's just landed okay. But he's made it a little bit tough for himself, close to the rail here, so any kind of queuing he'll be due will be hampered. Just looking at the angle here, he can't screw back for the one in the middle, I don't think. So he'll probably just be playing it possibly to top and coming off the left rail and back for the one in the middle. Definitely be taking that top ball first. Looks like he's running through on it. He's come up a little bit short there, a fair bit short actually. Probably hasn't cued that as nicely as he'd like. He left himself quite a difficult cut. The white ball will be racing, but should be able to control that off a couple of rails. And the black is wide open into five pockets, so as long as he pots this ball, he should be okay. It is not an easy pot, though. So we're looking at putting it in the left centre here. Just playing with the bottom so he makes it comes off that rail to the right-hand side. So fine, though. That white ball will race possibly back up to the top, but you would think he'd be able to control it down the bottom. It's been a fantastic event so far, and I know a lot of the players thoroughly enjoyed it and want to come back, so hopefully next year it's even bigger and better. Oh, he's played that beautifully. Sat fat. So here we go. It'll be scary. 2-3 down. Well done, Mick. So if you just joined us again, we do apologise. We've just come back from some technical difficulties. Dan had some problems with the data today, so just happy to get it back online and running. Will Farr sticking his nose in as usual. Have a good laugh with the boys. Michael Zupper sitting beside me, refuses to put the headset on, just not interested at all. So he's going to get a mention. He's having a good little giggle now. So scary to break at 3-2 down. We're looking to level up the match. Just notice with Michael's break, it does tend to lift the foot at the end. A little kick. Oh. And he just got called over the PA for a raffle win, so you won't see it. Oh no, he's going to keep playing. Someone else is going to pick it out for him. So here he goes for the break. Yeah, there's the little kick at the end. Which is a little bit feminine, but he gets a good spread. So he has put down two reds here and kind of split the balls quite nicely. He's got one, if he does go the reds, which look the better balls to opener anyway, he's got a one difficult red down the bottom here, which he'll be trying to extract. He has taken the reds here, so might just be playing containing safety here. Well, he's gone the double and containing at the same time. Kind of tried to play a bit of a shot to nothing, and it really has landed on nothing. If that's touching, he's just asked for it. That will be an absolute result for Mick. Yep, so looks like it is. So he'll probably just be looking to come off the rail here and sit against it if it is touching. And I believe it is, by the way, he's looking at it. Yep. He's just looking at what Joel can do from there. Not a whole lot if he gets it right. He'll probably have to come off the top rail. Anyway, Mick has to land it though. Yeah, he's played it nicely. A little deft touch. So Joel, not left with a whole lot. He's going to have to come off two rails here, you would think. Possibly one up and down the table, but you never know with these tables. The top players don't seem to like the reaction off a couple of the rails, although I haven't had problems with this exact one. So just having a good look. Scary does have that problem ball down the bottom here. Joel's probably too good a player to just leave him in behind, so he will have a crack at it. And it looks like he's gonna come off the top rail. Just the one and down. It's that time of the day where the boys are getting rowdy at the bar. JR hasn't quite been cut off yet, but probably shouldn't be too long now. And Joel's played that quite nicely. Just separated the only two balls that were kind of slight trouble, and he's left that problem ball for Scary. So Mick will be looking at the one in the centre to start off. And I think he's just having a look to see if that red goes in the other centre, which it does by the look of it, but he's had to get absolutely fat, so probably not an option. So he's taking the ball in the middle. And possibly another safety, it is. Hasn't left a whole lot on here. There's the yellow to the bottom left corner does go, so he'll probably be looking at that for Joel. Interesting shot from Scary. His game has moved towards a more Robbo style of percentages in the last, say, 6 to 12 months, and he plays them very well. So that'll be one of those shots, just letting Joel run his game. Saying, here it is, mate, have a go. So Joel's played quite a nice safety. He's only left him on the two bottom balls. So he's made Mick think a little bit there. So we'll just have to take a break from the commentary. I'm actually up at my table. And joining us will hopefully be Michael Zuppa. And here he is. Alright, we'll have a slight break from commentary as nobody is willing to take the mic. So we'll see you in a little bit, Big Gunners. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Can you hear me? No. All right, guys. We're sorry about all the unfortunate streaming episodes, but they have been recorded, so you can probably go back to them and look at those. So Dan's done an awesome job. Here we see a pretty big match. Joel and Scary. Joel's 4-2 up, as you can see on top of the screen. Yeah, he's got to develop this, obviously this red near the black here, I think. And he's been a bit unfortunate to just miss it. Hey, Marty.
Any chance you get on the microphone too? Go on.
Sorry, viewers, I was just trying to get Marty Andrews to get on the screen, but commentary box that he doesn't want to. Anyway, we see Mick here in a bit of a predicament. I think he's going to just run this in and then just maybe try and sneak a bit. He's loading it up, so he might be trying to develop it. And it's a bit too much. So now he's got a difficult decision what to do. So I don't know what he's going to do here. I don't know if that was a good shot, because he's left Joel a plant, which is definitely on, so I think there might have been a few more better options than what he's actually chosen. So Joel, to be honest, has probably got a simple plan here, and then leave the yellow down the bottom pocket, bottom right end of the screen. Can't believe Joel's missed that. So for all the viewers, Rusty's in the final. He's the grand champion. Whoever meets him, he's got to beat him twice. Very difficult task the way he's playing. Trying to get Graham Wright to come on the commentary box. Gra, come on. Just watch it here. It's one funny. Chuck the headphones on. Get on. Oh. Woody doesn't want to be here by himself. But here we see Mick. Probably just going through his mind whether he just cannons into this red on the rail or he just tries to just pot. And he's decided to pot and leave a big red down the bottom. Welcome to the commentary, mate.
Thanks.
At least you're barracked for the right team.
Thanks, Mark.
Played the pleasure of playing for the Bombers. So you've finally met a Bombers player. So
that's good. That's a good start.
That's a great shot. Like I just said to the viewing audience that he could have cannoned into that ball, but he's just left a hard shot. But he's got to go around the table here a bit, I think.
That's it. It's a big ball for 4-3.
Yeah.
Hope he gets it, because I've had a bet on Mick today.
Oh, look, he's definitely playing well enough.
Oh, he's stiff there. Very stiff.
And that's stiffer than a Roman Sancho. I can't believe he's done that.
Although,
He's probably...
I reckon he can swerve this round and get it in.
Oh, looking over the screen, it's probably more difficult than it looks on screen, but he's totally
jump up and swerve, or
he's got to do a baby swerve, I reckon. Oh, you got to go swerving.
Yeah.
Gives you a chance to pot it.
I think if he hits the cushion halfway up the left side, he might get it in.
Just got to hit soft enough to hold, I think. Just a soft shot.
Very unlucky not to.
That's as good as he could hit that.
Shot!
And as I said, soft. That is a very, very, very big shot.
Yeah, I took the 12-1 on Michael Scarry earlier today.
He's probably the freshest out of all. Like Joel said, to play two matches already, you know.
That's
so
right, yeah.
Looking in hindsight, he's
certainly and
he's doing
this,
pretty good.
At this stage, I think they're all these guys can mop up. I think it's who holds their nerve the best on the day, holds the mental stamina, the physical stamina the most, and a lot of people for some reason. Don't rate Mick as one of the top players, but I certainly think he's got the game to win at one of these tournaments, and maybe this is his time.
Ah, look, he's an awesome bloke too. Like he's loves the game, puts every effort into it.
Yeah, he's got a massive break off as well. Like I suppose they all do at the top, but I played him the other night. He didn't miss a ball off the break all match, and. I unfortunately couldn't get one off the break the whole match.
It's amazing, that, isn't it? Like some players just, you know, like Mick broke down and held the white perfectly in the middle of the table, which is what you want to try and do. And he's just got an awesome, awesome start. He's obviously going to take yellows and screw down for the one in the centre. Worried about
he
the bit
be
of
considering cushion first here and going for the yellows in the right middle, or
yeah, I don't know. I reckon he'll hit it thin and just
could
chop.
Go, like could go wrong, couldn't it? So
don't do too much. Just keep it simple.
He's got the cueing action.
Just a bit thin, which is what he's done.
Yeah, nice.
And probably gone too far.
Yeah, I think he's awkward cueing there for the balls up the top of the table. So you might have to.
Hopefully, he's got a little bit of angle there, but.
I have to pick this one at the bottom to the left corner.
To my liking, he's got a bit fancy there. I didn't think he just needed to roll it in, but he's trying to show Joel that he's playing well and potting well and.
I think he played to be underside of that rep to have options, two options, but he's left himself a little bit to do here, but I have to think one good pot and he's home and dry. Excellent shot.
Yeah, he's just potting so cleanly, isn't he?
Yeah, really clean, probably. And can't see anything going wrong from here, really. Hopefully not commentator's curse.
Joel's probably looked at that last shot and just saw, oh, geez, he's out of position and I'm going to get back to the table, but
yeah.
Another shot and he's just back in it again.
Okay, so slightly under hit, but shouldn't be a problem for him. I would probably be going into the red here to hold for the other yellow, but that's maybe the. Oh, that's perfect.
Yep. Screw into the rail, roll them in, and now it's all going to be nearly 4-4.
4 all, yeah.
And Mick Scarry's not going away. He says, no.
No, he's.
I'm not going anywhere.
He looks really focused, Mick, and. Does he beat me in this tournament? I'd like to see him.
How'd you go today, mate? How'd you go today?
Yeah, today I'm still playing, actually. I've got
Oh, yeah?
One more two more frames left.
Qualified, right?
and I've got four frames with two to play.
It's pretty tough out there. NTEC's probably one of the toughest I nearly reckon to make, because the big guns obviously have been here, and you got over this year, you got over 100 players playing in big guns, and that just makes it so much tougher to qualify today.
Oh, it does.
It's just amazing.
Well, going from the long frame, long rest format to the single frame format as well is quite
Very hard, isn't it? I was just telling one of the boys, or my son Matty actually, I was just telling him, I said, you just can't play in a sense the same way. You've got to be very, very strategic and just make sure you get that W. Like sometimes it's not about just potting out every time. It's one frame is very, very difficult.
Yeah, I struggle a lot with the fluency of the round robin format. It takes me a couple of frames to get into a rhythm and a cueing. And the stop-start element of frame every hour is definitely not suited to my type of play. But nice. If I can get through, I'm very happy. Because then it's the races which I prefer.
Yeah, it becomes difficult.
So Mick, got a couple of problems to negotiate here on reds. So he's just pulling the brakes on. And
yeah, he's done a really nice shot there.
He's won the last two frames. He doesn't have to chase the game now. He's right back in contention and fancies putting Joel under a bit of pressure here.
I don't like how he's left the white over this side, but Joel's got no option other than run this yellow up.
Yeah, it's time to get it between the gap of that red though, so it's worked out well for Mick. His plan worked, if you like.
Just once again, for all your viewers, Rusty Wheeler is in the final of the big guns. Won fairly decently against Scotty Matthews. The winner of this match, I believe, plays Alec.
Yeah.
And then the winner of that... Hang on.
Sorry.
Can you get me another drink?
Can you get me another drink? In the same glass. Jack and Coke. Jack. Heaps of Jack.
Sorry about that. Listen to me drink orders.
So we were saying that there's still another two matches for these players if they win.
Yeah, it's just going to be huge, isn't it?
In the final.
Yeah, it's just this going to go to...
It's a marathon, and it shows you how much it hurts if you lose in the front half. You've got so far to go.
Well, these guys, even Rusty's got to wait 4 to 6 hours to play.
Yeah.
You know, like I think he's gone home to his motel to try and relax and...
And,
you know, but I think, look, it's just so hard, it's so tough.
Yeah,
you know, these guys are playing for so many hours and they're waiting around for another result. And like, I don't know where Alex is at the moment, but.
Yeah, it's.
Bartender's dropped me a drink, but he kept the change.
It's a physical and a mental battle for these guys. And
It is, isn't it?
I'm a little bit surprised Mark Robertson hasn't got through to the final stages. I expected Mark to go close this year.
He just didn't have a chance. Like, he didn't really have much opportunity at the table, and I don't think he actually missed too much, but there was a lot of money on him. I think if he got to the Big Guns final, there was a $16,000 payout for all the viewers out there. But, you know, look, at the end of the day, he just really didn't get too many opportunities to get to the table, which, you know, in a race to 11's unheard of in itself as well. And
I heard someone say that he asked for a break after his match, his previous match to Rusty Wheeler, and it was
a bit of controversy yesterday. Which the actual truth of the matter is he just finished a match. And just wanted a 10-minute break to get something to eat, and you know, but obviously in hindsight, you know, these matches they went to 3 o'clock in the morning, so I think they're under pressure as well to try and get all these matches done. And credit to both people, you know, the player really, you know, needs a break as well, but in hindsight the incoming player might have waited 4 hours.
True.
So it is difficult as a tournament director, I suppose.
Yeah.
You know, in my thoughts, without being too biased to anyone, is, to be honest, 5-10 minutes not going to matter. You know, going to have a 5 minute break and then let's get it on again, and it's not going to be too big a deal. But at the same time, I think, you know, they're under pressure to get a lot of these games done. Obviously, you know, we're here at nearly 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and we've still got another 3-4 matches to go before we might even see a final. That's not right. 3-4 matches, but we've got at least 2 big matches. And
Mick's been very stiff there. He's missed a pot, and the ball's gone around the table, and he's accidentally potted one of Joel's yellows. So there's 2 shots here for Joel. 5 yellows remaining, and they're all potable.
You often see that, don't you? You know, you see him doing really nice, a person do a really nice out, and then all of a sudden they lose a little bit of concentration, and that's just the tiredness of, you know, these guys have been playing for nearly 3 days now.
Yeah.
It's just a split second, you know.
And who do you think will win this year, Mark?
Oh, look, definitely the informed player is definitely Rusty. He's, no one's even come close to him. You know, he's just in another league. Takes all his opportunities. When he seems to miss, I don't know if it's a bit of luck, but when he seems to miss, it just seems he doesn't leave too many opportunities for his opponent. But with Rusty, I've seen that he's just got so much ability to break and pot out. So even if he's 2 games behind, all of a sudden in 5 minutes, he'd sort of almost even again, you know. And the poor opponent has struggled for like 15, 20 minutes to get that lead, and all of a sudden he just sweeps it up. In he's just got that ability, like he's just brilliant.
Joel's he's not hit this one. It could have been a couple of inches closer to the black, it would have been unmissable. It's now missable, but he should still knock it in, no problem.
Wow. Well,
see what I mean? It was just that couple of inches shorter than he wanted. Just enough to make him think twice about it, you know what I mean?
I'm very shocked. And he had 2.
Of course he had 2. Of course.
Maybe it wasn't on. Maybe he's just...
No, it was definitely on.
Yeah, maybe to the camera. I think that might have been the case. That he just tried to set it over the hole and just overhit it a tiny bit.
Yeah. He's been knocking doubles in for fun this week, so...
Look, I think you'll see him cut it down just,
right,
just to cover the bag at least anyway, and put more pressure on Mick.
He'll want cushion first, then off the red here, in or over.
Oh, yeah, it's nearly clean, looking at the camera angle.
Yeah. Oh, that's beautiful.
Yep.
What a shot.
That's a great recovery from the mishap in the centre. I think Mick would have been licking his lips there for a minute. He would just say, yes, come on, give me another shot. But
I thought he was back. The interesting fact is that 2 years ago, Rusty Wheeler, you'll remember, lost the final against Joel with 2 lives. Princess.
Did he?
Won his final 2 years ago. So
well, I didn't know that.
If you're Rusty Wheeler, you probably would be quietly hoping to see the back of Joel Younger in this tournament, because if he turns up in the final again with 2 lives, or sorry, with 1 life against Rusty, with 2 lives, he might be a little bit concerned about a repeat of history.
Yeah, well, I think that could be one thing in the final that Rusty would be thinking about in the back of his mind. Like,
sure.
It's just one of those things that... Look, I played Joel yesterday in the winner's side, and... Look, he doesn't miss much. He's just a brilliant player.
He's had a lovely break there. He's got nice open set of reds to go for.
Tolson, one of those players, I reckon, that just creep up on you. Like,
okay.
You know, he's very timely in everything he does. He, you know, he, I don't know, just seems to drag each sort of game out a little bit longer than most players. Like, Rusty's a very fast player.
Yeah.
And I think that sort of holds him in good stead against someone like Rusty, you know, like slow his game down a bit and take his time. And
yeah, you give Rusty Wheeler rhythm, then you've got no chance.
That's good. Maddie's just qualified.
I'm just going to hand over the commentary to Jamie Stevens, who will take you through the rest of this match. Cheers.
Thanks, mate. With me old mate Jamie, the Woody and the Jamie.
The stream is back online. I've had a couple of sherbets.
Hey, why wouldn't you? Well, I did last night. Apparently, I really rubbished. I don't know what I said, but I kept the viewers entertained.
I've actually had a lot of requests, Woody, for me to do some drunk commentary. But what I'm going to do, because I've had some requests for me to keep it normal, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to do the in-between. I'm going to have a couple of socials. I'm going to just feel a little bit good about myself. And we'll do the happy medium. And I just actually popped over when I saw Joel miss that absolutely easy black in the middle and just played an absolutely super recovery black. That's good character.
Yeah, as I was saying just before, it was, I didn't realise he had two shots, but obviously he's trying to lay it up over the centre because he couldn't get past the red. But on the camera it looked like he could, but with the super x-ray vision that I have, I did realise it didn't go in the centre.
Well, Mix, actually, I think if we've looked at pretty much every one of Joel's matches in the last maybe three or four matches, they've all been close early, and then Joel tends to sneak away and get the win, so now, we'll need to be aware of that.
For all you viewers out there, Woody's just got to go and have a wee at one of his doodles and move back soon.
I'll solo up. As I said, Mick needs to be aware that Joel has been creeping up on players and then running them down. Now, one thing that with Joel, you will have noticed over the years that he's played the big gun comps, he doesn't play at a rapid pace. He's pretty methodical, pretty reasonably slow compared to some players, like say Rusty, for example. He's a very quick mover around the table, especially for such a big unit. But he tends to wear you down a little bit, and I don't know whether players are just not catching on to that and they're just sort of dropping some concentration and missing a few balls, because that's certainly what I've witnessed. But if you want to find a more determined player in the room, the guy on screen right now playing the shot will be the person, because you will not find a bigger bulldog than this bloke. And I'm not talking about his lips. Welcome to the commentary box, Matty.
G'day, Jamie.
And as we expect, and we always expect close matches in these race to 11s, just to draw it out even further.
Yes.
And, well, I'm just actually quickly looking at this. Mix played this yellow in the middle, and you would assume that he's just going to run down for the yellow to go inside the red, but I've just had a quick look at this, and the yellow does not pass the red straight enough to go off the red over the pocket. So he's either going to play for a double or something else. The only thing I can assume that he's actually played for an angle here to go and bump the red and try and move it out of the way of that path, but I think he's in trouble here.
I reckon it goes past that red on the rail there, Jeremy.
Matey, I think you are absolutely off your head, mate. I just don't see that being possible.
Well, he's going to come off that red anyway.
I'll tell you what, I just don't see it.
He wouldn't have played for it if he wasn't going, so.
Mate, I think this is a dream. I just don't see how he can slide past this red that he's closest to, the yellow, and still make the pocket. But I'll tell you what, you've got younger eyes than me, Matey, so I'm going to trust your judgment as he plays this shot. Look how good Matt Kerwood is. But he has not hit hard enough.
He might have not that much of a pocket here.
I'll tell you what, I need to go and relearn the game, because I've just made probably the worst call I've ever made on Keyboard TV was saying that. That wasn't on. But maybe this goes as well, the way he's lining this up. Well, it did go. He's actually cleared nicely, but he's Chinese snooker himself. Steve Tran has come to the party. He's in the room too, on the qualifying tables for Anzac Day tomorrow. And this will require just a nice little shot. This is a shot you don't want to dolly in, because, as I said, the naps are pulling the balls in a little bit, so you just want to cue this in. And that's what he's done, and in it goes, and it's a 5-all result. And a big shout out to anyone viewing. I don't even know who's watching this at the moment, but it's good to see that you guys keep tuning in and supporting their comp in their own way. If you're not here today and for various reasons, if you're watching the stream, that's great. But for the guys that are regular stream watchers, we'd love to see you get down here and play a few comps as well, just to keep the numbers up.
60 people watching.
So we've got 60 actual streams. I don't know how many people per stream are watching, but that's pretty good. And I do believe we have a bit of overseas presence as well. So, and that's fantastic that the Cueball TV has gone global. And a big break there too from Joel. And I'll tell you what, Matty, what do you like here? I like the yellows.
Yeah, reds aren't that high.
Reds look nice initially, but then you realise you've got to sort of place pinpoint positional shots, whereas yellows, you have a little bit more room to move, especially now.
Yeah.
Nice opening shot there from Joel, just to develop one of the more awkward yellows in this pot out. And obviously, really the only awkward yellow left now is the one that the white ball is closest to. He just needs to get some good position on it. I mean, obviously, it's not that bad, but you just need to get some good position on it just to clear it out of the way. And I'm sure that'll be the attempt this shot. So probably a bit of topspin, just run right through. And that's pretty good.
Yeah, that's perfect.
So Joel will now stun off side cushion, land on the ball in the middle of the table for the left center. And he will pick these balls off, I reckon, with not too many problems. Now, the actually a very important thing about this out too, and it's something that people will fall victim to and miss the out, and that's when you play this off this ball in the middle here, which is just played for now, there is no other option but to play for the ball on the right hand side of the table. You are working your way down the table. Sorry about that camera movement. Just had some clown just practically trip over it. So he will be potting this ball in the middle, and he will be basically standing back just past center table to the right hand side and playing the highest of the three. And as I say that, he's lining up the ball I'm talking about. But
he's disagreeing with your shot, Jamie.
That's nothing unusual. I swear they've got earpieces in, and Dan's like secretly putting them in and saying, listen, Jamie's going to say what shot you're going to play. Can you please play the opposite? And they are obliging yet again. The only reason I don't like this shot, Matt, is he's got to get up past centre again to make it nice and neat. But when you look at it, this is just a dead stun. He's got perfect angle for a little stun up off the side cushion. And you can land right behind that yellow. I misread once again, but he's still got the angle I've spoken about. So this won't be a run through. This will actually be a stun. So you'll actually see the white ball come off about three quarters of the way up the table before the center pocket. If you were to run through this, it'd come off the side cushion about halfway up. A stun shot will widen the angle and it will come off about three quarters of the way up, and then he'll be nice and straight, or just pass straight on the yellow.
Yes.
May even screw straight up the table if he prefers. And that's what he has done, but he's underhit it. But
looks
he's
like
still
he has
okay
to go around the table here.
Now, as you can see here, he's underhit this, so now he actually needs to move the white a little bit. or play probably a shot that will be more medium rather than short range on the black. So this is why I would have opted to eliminate this ball over the pocket earlier.
Is he going to screw it? No, he looks like he's going to top
looks
it.
Looks like he's going round.
Through the two reds.
Yeah. Nice shot, but still it's a medium range shot. He could have been, if he had eliminated that ball early and stayed down bottom side of the table, he would have actually had a much shorter range shot, but I do not expect Joel to miss this. And in it goes, and Joel says, Mick Scarry, how dare you even up the scores on me? I shall retake my lead. And if you've just retuned in again since the stream's come back online, I'm pretty sure we have hours and hours of stream left because I think there's another 2 to 3 matches after this to go before we reach the conclusion.
Yes.
Actually, the winner of this, I think, plays Alec, is it?
Yeah, the winner of this plays Alec, and the winner of Alec and whoever wins this plays Scotty.
And then we'll have a final.
And then we'll have a final. But if the loser person, whoever wins the loser side, beats Rusty, they have to play him again.
So potentially we have another 4 matches.
So Rusty,
not including this one.
Rusty's got a double chance in the final. But I don't see Rusty losing the way he's been playing throughout this tournament.
I agree, but I actually had 100 on Rusty earlier at $1.50 with the double chance, but I made a quick note to Travis and said, this 100's not safe if Joel's still in the tournament. I think Joel actually can beat Rusty because of his style. I shouldn't say Rusty will beat all the other guys because obviously everyone that's left is class act. But I just think Joel is, you know, with all the previous two years of winning this comp, he knows what needs to be done at the business end.
Yeah.
And he just didn't get quite into that enough. He wanted to obviously be a bit straighter on this ball in the middle. And a few problem balls as well also. He's got the one that's close to the 3 reds on the left-hand side. That's really the main issue, but a nice shot here from Joel. He's just missed the red, but gets a bit of second prize and gets the coverage over the pocket. And actually, I think he may have even totaled.
No, I think he can hit the edge of that red near that yellow on the left side of the table.
Well, that's actually even a better result. You actually don't want to total. You'd rather Mick be able to actually hit something. You are right, Matty. He can play this ball, but do you really want to move these?
Yeah, you don't really want to move these balls.
I'd almost rather come off of that cushion and backdoor the red that's near the... Well, he has moved and he's actually opened the frame right up. You saw my name flick up there for a sec. I thought I was still in the comp, but I'm not. And just a quick shout out to Della too, you suck for losing straight after beating me. And actually, just if you do stay tuned in, I will have a special guest on here later doing some commentary. He will give up an hour of his time, and that will be Mick Hill. I think today's the only day I've been able to get him sober so far.
I don't really think he's sober. He's continued to drink.
He's only had a couple of socials, though. I actually tried to have a round with him, and he wasn't keen. So I think he's actually trying to look after himself a bit today, because he's actually playing in the Anzac Day comp. So I'll get him in commentary a little later on, and we'll get some good insight from the multiple world champion.
So yes, the winner of this match plays Alec. Alec bet Kurt Dunham.
I'll get you one when you're ready.
So that was a very loose shot there from Joel. It's like he actually didn't really decide what he wanted to do there.
I think Mick's just going to try to cover this right corner pocket where Joel's yellow.
I'm actually wondering if he could have a dip here, Matty. I'm wondering if he'll actually try and just punch it in and just clear the yellow now. One thing I have found about these tables, when you're playing over distance and soft, you generally don't hit the spot you're aiming for. They are drifting a touch, and attacking the balls, I have found, is the recipe of the day. The problem with attacking the balls all the time, if you miss, you lose.
He looks like he's swerving.
He's swerving, yeah.
Cover. That's a reasonable good shot there.
The problem with his shot is Joel will just push his yellow into the pocket a little closer.
I don't think he can see it, actually. No, the other one, yeah.
Surely he can, but he's just going to bust this out instead. Well, he's potting the red.
Pot the red. Well, that's not, actually not that bad.
Yeah, it's not the most damaging shot in the world, but I still think Mick can promote and force this yellow away from the pocket too. And it's pretty interesting this. Mick gave me a bit of a hard time about my tactics last time I was on stream with him commentating. So let's just see how his tactics go. Because I've actually never been a massive fan of Mick's his tactical game.
I think he's just going to try to pot out here with two shots.
Well, there you go. Yeah. That just proves what I'm talking about. That was a shocker. He almost has no choice but to pot the yellow over the hole, but that's actually suicide. Too easy and out for Joel, so perhaps pushing the red onto the side cushion, but then he's just going to get it straight out, so... Those that are interested, there's obviously a lot of prizes for amateur, intermediate, and that sort of stuff in cash. I think there are 6 amateurs fighting for $1,000, and they're having a playoff. It's the same thing. I've suggested that they just play. Look at the stats, Matty. Woody doesn't like that because he doesn't think Matty will be there. But the other option is just to play a rare robin race to 3 or something like that, and see what happens. But I did the smart thing. I went up to Steve Gray. I said, what do you want to do, Steve? Do you want to play for it or split the cash? I'm happy to split it. He said, yeah, let's split it. I had a feeling he would because he's as tired as I am. And so we shall take a $400 note each and get our entry money back. Plus, I think we picked up 100 for the distance we got. So all in all, pay for the weekend, plus a couple of socials and some good pool. Oh, okay, Mick's going to cover up here. He's not going to pot this. Oh, God, he's played that really well. I thought he played that bad for a second. He's played it very well. Well, because he's got such good coverage of that yellow, it's time to start moving those two balls he's right near. He really needs to double the red, I think, and get to the left-hand side pocket and just put something in the way of the black. Never mind. He's not even at the table. They've both got bald heads these days. I'm just losing me one. For some reason, I thought Mick was still shooting after he played that very good layup. I'm just interested what Joel does here, because he can't just go ahead potting all these balls. It's, Mick can still kick this red out, so interested to see what Joel comes up with here. I think that Joel might screw off a side cushion back across. No, I'm not sure what his game plan is here.
Hi, Jamie.
Well, if he puts a black over the pocket, I don't agree with his shot, because at the end of the day, Mick can start farming out his red balls away from that pocket, and that red that's on the back of the yellow definitely kicks out. So this, to me, not the right shot. So anyway, the tactical prowess of Mick Scarry needs to be displayed here. So Mick, I know you didn't try and give me too hard a time in the commentary when I played Robbo, but I'm going to give you maybe a bit of a hard time if you play this out wrong. But obviously, I don't think Mick could be going out at this visit. And Mick needs to be smart the way he manipulates his reds here, because, and the reason I say that is because Joel will want to keep pushing a red down to that pocket. He won't want to push it really, really, really close, but he'll want to push in the area. That way Mick can't kick both balls out at the same time. And Mick will need to put himself eventually in a position where Joel can't actually do that, and Mick will still have an option to kick out that red and keep his second visit. So This will take a while to pan out, this frame, if it plays in accordance to what I've just suggested. So Mick's just going to cause some problems with this black. Actually, I would like to get your insight here, Matt, as a young fella, and what you would do in this position. Because it's a tough position to be in, and there are a lot of options available. So fire away, Matty. Tell me what he's going to do, and tell me how to win this frame from here. Matty has decided he does not know how to win this frame from here, so you will hear only my voice for the next 20 minutes.
Apparently how you get...
Well, that was a poor miss there from Mick. So Joel's got to be thinking to himself now, well, you know what? I don't know why I'm putting the black over the other pocket. I could probably put it over the pocket where the yellow is. Obviously, you risk the smothering of that pocket, and then suddenly the black... you can obviously put the black on the back of the red and give two shots, and then they've got to kick it out in one and get a good result.
I think Scurry needs to just clear all these balls out and get them over holes so Joel actually can't double them back over.
That's Ricky Lee again.
So that's a pretty good shot for me, but the thing is here, Joel's probably just going to push up this red that's in the center of the table. Now if I'm Joel here, the natural feeling for a player here would be push this to the side cushion. Whereas I think the better shot is to actually push it to the bottom cushion. Much harder to actually obviously play a double and get a big result, and then you've got two to kick out the red. So I want to kick this red about less than a foot away from the corner pocket on the bottom cushion. If he doesn't like that shot, then the double on the black cross table comes into play.
Or he just cuts it across.
Could cut it across as well, yep. I like the double only because you can bring the white ball back up the other end of the table. But it's less risk involved playing your shot, Matty, where you just cut it over. Matty's shot. I'll tell you what, I'm just wondering how close this red is to the yellow.
I think he's going to have to come off the bottom rail and get it out that way. Well, obviously, if he gets it out any other way, I think it's going to hit that yellow in.
Yeah, and the reason I like this black being over here, Matty, is you can't just simply kick it out.
Yeah.
By hitting it direct. So I think Giles played the right shot there.
And I'm out.
I was going to do some trying to pick as well. That's fine. So we just found out that the starting frames for the final will be done by Mick Hill and Sean Budd. Apparently I'm not good enough to commentate that final, so they're going to kick me off, and I'll jump on later on once they've had their fill. And Steve has taken the headset off Matty. He says, Matty, get out of my way. I know these tactical games. I'm going to get involved. Steve, qualified today?
Yes, I did. Thanks.
Very nice.
I left it late, though, but finished well.
I like your insight on this frame, Steve, being new to the tactics game, being a proficient snooker player.
Yep.
Mickey's on reds.
Mick's on reds, is he?
And
is he going to put the black on top of the red, then?
Well, the problem with that is the angle that he's got for that black to put it on there is horrible, and to not leave a foul snooker and keep the red tight on the red would be very difficult. He's in a real tough spot, and Joel will make sure that he continues to stay in a tough spot, and he'll probably double this red back down that end of the table. And as he has done so, I'll tell you what's good about that shot, Steve, and that is if that was actually closer to the black, you can then sort of kick the black out, and then you can get yourself back in position where you can try and pick up two and kick the red out. Now, I mentioned at the start of this tactical battle, once the Mick put the red on the back of the yellow, that Mick will need to manipulate his balls in such a way where Joel can't foul and keep killing his reds, and that's actually a very difficult thing to do. See, now, if I'm Mick here, I actually double the red and kick the black out.
Double the reds.
Off the back cushion and kick the black out. It doesn't matter if the red stays there, because you can actually hit that with the white ball, but you can't hit the black with the white ball.
Okay. So,
and that's the right shot there from Mick. So the black is now away from that pocket, even though he didn't promote it as much as well as he would have liked. And the other good thing about that shot is Joel can't really put the black back down there, so...
I mean, does this red double?
It doesn't double. It can only be backdoored and kicked out, the one near the yellow, so... And this is why Joel's like, oh, geez, I'm not sure if I should pot this or not. Do I just play the red sort of closer there again? And he's looking at the black. So I think what he's looking at now, potting the red, I think this is the right shot. I think this is definitely the right shot.
But leaves the white up in the bulk?
Absolutely. He wants to leave it to the left-hand side of the table. And that's pretty good. There's no cut available. Mick needs to play something massive to even, like, keep two shots.
I think Mick will come off the top cushion and kiss the red half ball.
The only problem with that is, obviously, the black's not on, so we'll need to play a double. And he also needs to get a good land. He needs to get a shot.
He'll back himself, though, because he needs... he's against the wall here. He needs to do something.
It's the right shot because if he doesn't land well, like just there, he hasn't landed well. The black is still in. The black is still tough. So even if Joel is on the yellow, he's still got to play a good shot on the black. Yeah. So that was definitely the right shot to kick it out. And Mick was very patient there and waited.
I think the obvious shot here, Jamie, you obviously spot the snooker straight away. Promote the red, and even if Joel pots this difficult snooker at yellow, he's got a very difficult black as well under pressure. So
absolutely, and this is where Joel has to make the decision. You know what? Do I just foul and put the red over and let him kick it out in one and take the double on himself, or do I go up and down and I take the difficult black on? And the answer is I'm going to foul. And that's not a bad shot.
It's not bad. The same shot's coming right up though.
Mick will have a chance to double this in one. This first red.
I think he'll try and extract it straight away as he did previously, but not hit it as hard as he did before. He may even, if he's lucky, cushion first, clip the red half ball, and then promote the black as well in the same shot, but he's got a different plan.
He wouldn't be able to have to clip the half ball, he'd have to clip a quarter ball, Steve, and let the white run thin. But he's played off three, he's gone the marks double, and
beautiful.
He just bends his knees. He does a Donnie Colbert special. Or a Jimmy Rean special. Jimmy Rean's not bad at that either. However, he's actually played a very good shot there. He's given himself every opportunity to run this rack now.
Mick Hill's just walked in.
He has.
Would you be doubling this black all day, Mick? And bring it out.
Yeah, I'm exactly in agreement with Mick there. I'd be looking for the kick out myself. And he's definitely not got the kick-out angle there. So Mick doesn't like your option.
A little
Mick.
Bit of a shocker.
Mick don't like Mick.
If this double doesn't go in, Mick will replay this match and maybe...
Well, he's landed perfect, I reckon.
But remember, these cushions are not doubling
easily. I've worked these out, Steve. I really have worked these out. I love them. I think they straighten up. Everyone else in the room except me, I think, thinks that they spread wide. I think they straighten up and you've got to aim wide. And in that goes, and Mick Scarry has played a very good frame.
Well done, Mick.
How do I bag him out now about his tactics?
Well, as I mentioned earlier today, I've had a bet on Mick Scarry today.
What were the odds?
12-1.
That's a good bet. I was almost going to back Scotty Matthews at sixes.
Oh, that's a good bet.
I didn't do it, but although I was almost going to.
I think Rusty pretty much demolished Scott earlier today, so...
Yeah, Scott didn't play well.
I actually went
over and asked what Rusty's odds were with the double chance, and I got $1.50, so I just whacked 100 on it. I thought, why not? But this man here on screen is probably the only bloke I think can beat him.
I think you're
twice.
I think you're right.
Just because of, he's won it twice. He knows what it's all about. There's still some extremely proficient players left.
There is. I mean, obviously, hoping Mick can get up.
I think Alec is also a very big danger.
Yes, there's plenty of big guns left in this event.
And so that break didn't really come out very well as far as the spread's concerned. At this game, I think this is what keeps the players coming back over and over and over, is if you can ever work out the break where you can get all the balls to spread perfectly and you've got an easy out every frame, and that's when you can give up the game, retire, and say, I'm too good for this game. But that's just not possible, unfortunately, and that's what keeps us coming back over and over again, to find that perfect break and that perfect game. So Joel takes the reds, and I think maybe what he's looking at is to pop this in the middle and then play this sort of four reds all near each other, and the one above the yellow will go to the corner inside the yellow. And I'm thinking maybe he's going to play that and try and develop some balls, but he has a fair bit of angle on his ball in the middle, I think. He's got the ball to the corner. Actually, sorry, I've just reevaluated this, Steve. You can actually pick these off one by one. Once you start potting one ball, it opens up the next ball.
It's it's pretty much A, B, C, although some difficult parts involved. So, have to excuse the background noise, everyone. We have a party going on behind
us. Lunatic crowd has kicked in. And he's missed that pot. He's
missed it and not covered the pocket also, so this has opened the door for Mick. And these are the type of chances I think Michael will need to take to if he's going to win the tournament.
Absolutely, and there is an out on here as well. Obviously that yellow that's stuck in between the reds looks really hard, but pretty much a foot down from where the white is down, the cushion, it's obviously available in the middle. So he's got balls that he can use to get on it.
Yeah. He's got two connecting balls, hasn't he? A little bit of pressure on this ball, though. Because if he misses...
He won't miss this. So he wants to land pretty straight on this next yellow down the cushion.
Oh, he may have got a kick.
And sort of the hell he was doing this.
I think he is quite straight on this. I think he wanted a little bit more angle. I wonder if he's got to borrow some of the pocket.
Tell you what, if that was me clean the water, I would actually at least ask Joel. Told him I was going to do it. He's just whacked the chalk down.
No, I think he did ask.
He did? Okay, yeah, he's done did. It without me seeing. See, that was quick.
It was quick, yeah. But
I was wondering what the hell he was doing there for a second. He didn't see the chalk go down.
He's not that cheeky.
I thought he was just wiping something off near the ball.
And did you qualify today, Jeremy?
I actually didn't have to qualify, which is fantastic, because I was in today's earlier frames for big guns.
Good shot.
Yeah, Mick actually tried to pot that, obviously, and he just used a little bit of right-hand side to get a nice angle on
the
yellow.
You think he tried to pot?
Absolutely, because he's fat on that yellow. He just stuns it in. Then he's also on the next yellow that's just below, like to the very left of the white, and then he's just got a little drop in on the yellow and pots the black. So he absolutely tried to pot that. So
mixing a bit of strife here.
This is a smart shot from Joel. This is exactly the shot I would play.
Drop it in?
Yeah. The only reason I say it's a shot I'd play is because kind of doesn't have heaps of choices but to play it, and I hope that Mick makes a mistake.
I would be doing something here, but probably the wrong thing, because I don't have much pool knowledge yet. And that would be, I'd be trying to pot the first yellow off the red into the middle pocket.
It's not that bad a shot, Steve.
If Mick does that, he's looking at the plant into the other centre pocket
this
here.
This is a bit dangerous.
I actually like the other one better, don't you?
Well, all I care about here is opening them up and having a shot on a ball.
And I believe if he does that plant that I've suggested, I think it'll promote the other yellow into the middle pocket if the white comes over this side. The left side of the top yellow.
I think the reason he's trying to hit the yellow first
or
is to make sure it
shoots
out.
Or he'll do none of the above and absolutely... Yeah, probably pot in the corner now or something.
No, he's jacking up just to hold the white.
Oh dear.
Oh, he's pot the yellow.
He's had a absolute disaster there.
Yeah, he's just misread that, I think, that shot.
He'd be really upset with that shot. 6-all against Joel Younger, you just can't afford that.
Yeah, I think he's had some good fortune, I think, and those two reds above the two yellows, I don't think they pot.
I think they go, mate.
So he may have to go into these now and try and get some development.
The bottom one's on, he'll just pot that and screw back, I think. Oh no, he prefers the corner pocket. Okay.
Yeah, I think this is a natural angle just to stun into him.
Just stop, drop it in.
Oh yeah, okay, this tells me something's on.
I think he's fine.
I think he's going to play the billiard shot here, Steve. He's going to play the red at the top corner and let the other one, the white ball, just promote the other one.
I think the right-hand one goes, doesn't it? In the middle?
Geez, I don't know if he does. You'd think he would have played already, but
you would have thought so, wouldn't you? But maybe he's not sure.
Well, you might be right, Steve, because he just sort of lined up a double for the second red. Or he's going to play his bottom ball and land on the bottom. The bottom of the two reds must cut into the middle. If you land in the right spot.
There. Yeah, so he wants.
Yeah, if it does, he's landed
perfect
absolutely perfect.
That is a beautiful shot. He's got the white on a piece of string, this guy, hasn't
that
he?
That was a fantastic shot. So he's just going to push
still
through
two shots, so it's...
off the yellow.
Sayonara.
While Joel just finishes up his front row rack, I'll be back shortly.
Two shots on this black, so nothing fancy, just drop it in. And there's the tournament organizer, Travis Crawley, done an excellent job. It's a massive project running this tournament, and he's put hundreds of hours in the weeks leading up to the tournament, and credit to him, he's done a fantastic job, and we hope we have him back next year to run it again. And I'm sure there's a few things that he would improve on this year, a couple of little kinks, but otherwise massive effort, and hopefully he'll run to a reasonable time tonight and not 3 o'clock in the morning as it did last year. So Kevin Malik's just turned up. He reckons it's a 1 o'clock finish, and if it isn't, he's promised to get everyone a drink. So credit to Kevin Malik. He's a good bloke and a good player as well. Gave me a good seeing to today on the Anzac round robin group. Not that that's very difficult, the way I play pool, but he certainly played well. Graham Wright, the finalist of Geelong's, just turned up, sporting a fashionable hat. And he's a player in very good form recently. So excuse the background noise, there's a party going on behind us. A lot of the pool players like to have a few drinks in the closing stages of a tournament. And it's a great atmosphere in the venue tonight. It's electric, and we're just waiting while an intermission, while Mick takes a comfort break. In fact, I'll be back in 1 minute.
All right, so Gus has decided to don the headset.
Hey, yo,
no,
everyone.
Pun intended there, since Don Cobb is sitting right next to me. And Joel is going, well, he's already looking like he's going to pot out a Reds Gus man.
Yeah, I wouldn't put anything past him. He's the ultimate professional solid.
He is. And do you reckon that black goes past the yellow to the corner? If it does, this should
probably
not,
off the jaw.
Shouldn't be too hard an out, but if it doesn't, well, then there's a bit of work to be done.
I'm sure he'll manufacture something solid. He's that good.
Even that three-ball plant needs to be played right, and he's just lined it up. And if he does play the three-ball plant, the first red that he contacts will actually cannon into the yellow above it, and he'll have a pretty... They'll hold pretty well. Just overhit that a touch, and as he sort of shows it in his facial reactions, but...
Yeah, he wanted to come a bit further.
No, he wanted to be... I think he wanted to be a bit lower, so he could sort of play it naturally. Now the white ball's travelling away from the action. He could have the two-ball plant. Well, he does have the two-ball plant.
Yeah, there you
plant.
Go, that's...
So
Gus, that's what I thought, yeah.
Gus, Donnie's coaching me in the background like he used to when I was a kid, and it's coming into the fray right now as he chooses the right shot for me yet again. I tell you guys out there, must be absolutely sick of me just calling shots that are just 100% wrong all the time, Millie. I might have to just stop it. Gus, what do you think?
Well, I step in half plastered and call the right shot first up.
You do, and so. It actually annoys me that people do that. So I might have to kick you off very shortly. And well, what do you reckon about that shot, Gus?
Well, I'm not too... he's going to leave that red to the right middle left, obviously, to get on the black. So he'd want to hit this one. He'd want to come far enough.
Yeah, this sort of shot here, if he does play the ball in the corner, which I'm assuming he will. Now, he's obviously got a screw back half table.
Yep.
This requires good cueing. It's as simple as that. You must cue the ball well. If you don't cue the ball well, you're not going to land right. And well, that's not bad. He'll definitely settle for that. And it's all about Gus. It's black. This black has to go because there's no way he would have run all these balls and not risk not getting a cannon earlier on in the out.
It is. It actually looks tighter when you look at it live. I think it might go.
I reckon it goes. Yeah, I reckon it's slightly obstructed, but I reckon it goes. And he'll just sort of drag this in a touch. And you actually saw the white ball slow up a bit at contact. That's just a little bit of drag on the white, so just hitting just below centre with a good technique. It's actually a very difficult shot to play if you're learning to play the game. Shots, when I use the words, you know, obviously there's guys that are new to the game and you know, still learning some of the shots. Shots like drag, soft screw, stunt run throughs, these sort of shots, they're more advanced shots, and they take some good cueing techniques to actually master and play consistently.
Yeah, so that black went easily in the end, Jamie.
It did. I'm glad I got something right, Gus.
8-6 to Joel.
And I actually went to take a break, and Mick's actually happened to walk in as well, and we had a quick chat about that previous frame where he actually fouled straight back to Joel when Joel gave him two, and we discussed the options that he could have played there. Obviously that he's already forgotten about that frame, it's dead and buried, but what he didn't want to see is Joel run the next rack of his break. Mick did say that he was a little bit upset that he's just thrown away a few frames, and believe me, mate, I know exactly how you feel after my last match doing the same thing. But it's all part of the game, and we know the guy that makes the least mistakes is the person that's going to win the tournament. That's why I'm sitting in the chair.
Well, Jamie, I'd just like to congratulate you again. You just keep doing it time after time, mate.
I'm not doing enough. No. That's the problem. I have high expectations of myself, and I want to win something one day, and I'm sure that will happen.
You just keep. That's why you're solid, because you are as solid as it gets, mate.
I try to be. I'll tell you what, I'm actually more. I'm more liquid now.
Unlike both of us on our doubles performance.
Yeah, we'll forget about that. That day if it happened. So Joel did not want to take a ball on there, and he's played a little safety.
I just like to point out, a lot of people want to get Ricky Lee on the mic. Chat's going crazy.
Oh, I think we're going to have to boycott Ricky Lee. He's had a few sherbets today, and he pretty much, while his voice was entertaining in the in the match between Robbo and Della, the analytics of the game went completely out the window. And there's a playoff going on for best female, which is between Linda Lallement and Rhianna McLaughlin. That's all I'm going to say about that.
Gee, that's going to be a cracker matchup, I think, solid.
That's all I'm going to say about it, mate. We're obviously not going to be covering that. We have other matches that are still part of the main draw in progress, so obviously we'll focus on those. But I'll tell you what, if we actually did put the camera on them, at least you'd have some candy.
Daisy, what's the score of there? It's 1-0, not sure who to though, but yeah.
Surely they're not playing race to 11. You are kidding me. Alright, well, good on them. I'm actually surprised they're actually playing race. Oh, me and Steve just split the cash, I don't know why they're playing off the rip, but anyway. Rio did say she wanted the wank factor claim. Anyway, back to this. Joel's played another little safety.
Sure.
Yeah, he hasn't played it very well because obviously he wanted the wide bottom cushion and tucked in between the two balls clustered together on the right side of the table.
So who's favourite here, Jamie, looking at the balls?
Well, I think at the moment the favourite is the person at the table because... You know, both balls, there's obstructions for both balls. That's a very good shot from Mick, good containing shot. And Mick has actually maybe slowly taken a bit more control over this frame because obviously that red that he's just covered up with the yellow a little bit more.
Gee, I tell you what though, Mick looks extremely focused and every time he plays it looks like he wants to kill his opponent, like actually injure him.
Well mate, I think we've affectionately nicknamed Mick the Bulldog of Pool because he is the male Bulldog in Victoria. He does not give up and he's got extreme determination. And it's a very good quality to have and I think that's coupled by his ego. But the thing is, he wouldn't actually have that determination if he didn't have the other characteristics. So I'm not actually hanging shit on him there. I'm actually giving him a rap. I actually went to England 1 year with Mick, played for Australia, and they have a separate comp over there and called the Masters. And then if you don't sort of qualify in the Masters, you're playing what's called the Plate. And while the Plate isn't as near as prestigious as really the other comp, it's still worth, I think, £1,000 or something to win. And Mick fought his way through match after match after match to make the final of that. And unfortunately, he didn't win it, but still, the determination that he showed and some of the very good pull, great to watch. And I was there supporting him through as many matches as I could because, you know, obviously, being a fellow Aussie, want him to go well, but one thing I noticed about him is when he gets going and he's flowing, he actually can beat anyone in the country, if not the world, when he actually is flying. He has a very sound technique, and as we said, as we've already spoken about, the determination.
He just played a great shot just before. He's opened everything up, and the out is now on.
Yeah, this ball on the rail here, at the bottom of the table. I'm just wondering whether he plays it now or whether he just leaves it as his last ball.
Yeah, I think he'll leave it to his last ball.
I've actually, personally, Gus, I've found the balls down the run on these tables really tough. Whereas I've been watching other people just knock him in, so it's been quite annoying.
Yeah, I found these tables actually tricky to play on. I've played on them a few times and, yeah.
They are, they're real challenging. And obviously some of the other guys are mastering quicker than others. I think Robbo's had a bit of a nightmare on these tables.
Mick's underhit that shot.
Yeah, you may be forced to play a thin two-ball plant here. I think this is the shot, just purely because even if you don't quite get the pot, the yellow should probably stay over the hole, and you'll have some coverage at least. And if you get the pot, obviously you've got the ball to the centre. So I think this is the only shot available. So, well, he hasn't played it very well, but he's still got the coverage. And in fact, actually, I think he may have even played for that, because where he's left the white, he wouldn't really want to have been playing off there himself.
He has given Joel an opportunity, though, to break out that red. Pot this red in the right middle and leave angle to the red to the left corner. Extract the other red
for the kick out, absolutely. Yep. But even still, a big out to be played after that. Yep. So, and that's attributed to the ball on the bottom right hand, close to the bottom right hand cushion. When they're in that sort of vicinity, they're actually not easy shots. So, the shot you suggested, Gus, I don't reckon he's come far enough, has he?
Oh, it's definitely
well, no,
an
angle,
actually,
he has.
Yeah.
The problem with this, though, he has to force the wide a little bit. So, if he hits bottom side of the red when he gets the kick out, a pretty high chance of colliding into the yellows and potting one of them. So
yep.
I think you want a more natural angle. It's like if you can move the white ball across 2 foot like this is perfect. Yep. Now there's a natural angle where you can go into a full ball and play the kick out.
Now we'll see some action.
So I shouldn't have said natural angle, because he does need to stun this a bit. Well, it looks like he's playing with right hand side instead of stunning it. Well, he stunned it as well. He didn't use any side, he just stunned it. He's just missed the cannon. Even if he just flicked that cannon, then it wouldn't have been any good for him. So he's actually been off by a good full ball there.
They're just playing containing safety here.
And that's a pretty good shot. Like, a lot of people would have just trickled off that and tried to leave the white ball hard up, but
that's actually a better shot than what I initially thought.
Yeah, it is, because he's got the full snooker and he's also blocked the cross table. Yep. Shot off.
Forcing Mick to play one of these yellows to the top right corner.
Yeah, I think Mick can be mad to pop one of the balls in the top corner right now. I think the shot is to either leave the white hard up on the red or play the black up to the yellows. I'd just leave the white hard up on the red myself. So I'm not sure about this, unless he gets it really tight. That just gives Joel a little bit of room to move there, I think.
Might have to go the one to the centre if it goes, but
yeah, that's why when I saw Mick aiming up to the side cushion, I thought, geez, there's a chance to leave him on here to the middle. I'm just not sure if it goes though. He's played a little flick off, and this red's going to go up to the corner now and just cause some more traffic.
Mess things up a bit more. So he'll play this with a bit of force to try and knock out the yellows.
This actually could go very wrong. Jizzy played it well though, and well, it didn't quite get the result that he may have looked for or even maybe deserved in that matter, but the yellow's not flush over the pocket. And indeed, red will pass inside that, so it's still a pretty good shot from Joel.
So what happens if the winner of this match, do they go to the semi-finals or?
The winner of this will play Alec, and then the winner of that will play Scott Matthews. And then the winner of that will play in the final against Rusty, who has a double chance. So
they have to beat Rusty twice.
A lot of pool left. I'm pretty sure Mick's intention there was to actually play that double and put the yellow in front of these two reds that he's looking at the plant now. And then Joel would have actually not had a hell of a lot on offer.
Getting a bit of a rap here, Jamie, in the chat. Danny Quatch loves your work, mate.
Oh, can't actually even read any of that.
No,
my eyes
said
are square,
thinks
sorry, guys.
You're calling, and he loves listening to you. Helps his game heaps.
Well, thank you, mate, very much, Danny.
My eyes are square though now. Right now, I'm so tired. I've been playing pool for like 16 hours yesterday.
Yeah, zero sleep.
But that's what we do. We love the game, and I do actually love calling the game as well. And I think the other great thing about commentating is you can watch what the players are doing, and you can learn from it as well. And I'm an animal of learning. Love to keep learning in everything I do.
It's a mixed force to do something here.
Yes. Well, he can play a little snooker here if he wants to. You know, like a containing shot as well. Or he can take the big shot on. He can take the pot on. You know what? If this is me, I'm taking it on.
Yeah, I think you've got it, really.
The only reason I say that, that's a great shot.
Yeah,
the only reason I say that, Gus, is because that's pretty much all I've been doing this weekend, is just taking it on most of the time. Sometimes it's worked and sometimes it hasn't. So the whole idea here will be to get on this ball on the side rail, just off straight, and just roll it down. Natural position on the black, and if he does miss it, well, he's got some coverage on the red. That's a nice shot there from Mick.
He's still going to have that tricky ball on the rail.
Yeah, I think he'll play the run through here, Gus. Just get over back over the side cushion. Where he actually is right now is not a bad angle. That's an even better angle there from Mick, and a spectator in the crowd has just given that a quick clap. May have even had a couple of dollars on Mick there. So that is a very good shot. Now, Mick's sort of faced the decision, do I punch this in for perfect position, or just roll it in and play a slightly harder shot?
Well, you just roll into the centre.
Well, he's punched it in. That is very, very good cueing from Mick, and he will go to 8-7 down now. Barring this black hitting the pocket as the silly dipshit behind the bar walks across his shot, not knowing any better, so we can't really blame him.
In the women's, we're at 2-1, Jamie.
Yeah, I don't know if you just saw that walk past, but that is a fair way to cut that place, Scott. He's got hair just hanging off him all over the place, random shavings and mohawks and just going on everywhere. That's off its chops, that haircut.
In the women, we're at 2-1. Not sure.
They're flying. They're flying, guys.
They are actually on.
They played three frames.
Big crowd over there too, mind you. I mean, there's a big crowd.
Now, Gus, this is not the year to be giving the girls a hard time. They actually outplayed the doubles this year to the girls and the guys in the Vicks. So I've
stepped
been
it up, you reckon?
Well, I've taken it easy on the girls this year compared to last year.
I
ruffled a few feathers last year, so I'm trying to make amends, and I didn't actually have to make amends because they did it for me. And a big break there from Mick. Pots of ball, white ball's got sort of been lost a little bit on the cushion. And well, it's a very good safety if you don't want to be playing the next shot.
Even Danny Lynch is just side there. He's
I wonder who Dan's going for. As far as I knew, Dan was completely impartial as being the Kidball TV president. And as it turns out, he's actually very Victorian biased. Hang on a minute, they're both Victorian.
Yeah. Well, what do you fancy here, Jamie?
Well, I like the reds. And the only reason I say it is because I think maybe I can unlock this all I can pot. Might be able to sneak through to the yellow in the middle.
Yeah, so he has put a yellow, so he's just going to
play a little tickle snooker. Well, that's not a bad shot either. And, well, he has left, I think. Hang on, I can't tell now, but...
Nah, he hasn't. Snow.
No, Oh, which is, I think he's left him off the straight pot to the corner. It's hard to tell.
Oh, yeah, I don't think
even if he comes cushion first, it doesn't really leave a lot. And that's what he's done. He's come cushion first because I don't think he could pot it. And as you can see from the result, Mick doesn't really have a lot on offer. At least he doesn't have an option to pot out, I don't think, of this visit. When you actually look at this game and you break it down to its basics, all you're really doing is trying to stay a shot ahead of your opponent. That is the primary aim of this game. And when I say that, that means you're not potting out of that visit. So if you're not potting out of that visit, you're saying, what can I do to make sure that my opponent, when he comes to the table, can't pot out either? Which effectively means you're going to get another shot, so you're a shot ahead. And that battle goes to and fro until somebody makes a mistake or somebody plays a big shot and develops an out. That right there is the single passion for this game.
You are absolutely spot on, Jamie.
Other than finding the perfect break and being able to never miss.
Oh, well, there's Joel's snooker prowess coming to play there. Well,
I can tell you right now, he's kind of played that as a shot to nothing, and that is... Yeah. Well, that's actually ridiculous, that shot. That is a great shot.
He's snooker.
Let's be honest, that is ridiculously good shot.
That was his snooker background coming to the fore there.
It was indeed. And that deserved nothing less than a tap on the table as well, so...
Mick might even just roll up to this red.
I think it's the only option, Gus, I really do, because unless he can actually get out of the snooker and he's very confident to hit one of his balls. If he could actually get out of it and pot one, I would. Sorry, not pot one, but hit one, I would. But if you can't really hit the ball out of the snooker, I would just do the layup and make him waste one. And that's what he's done. Now, you'll notice he's pushed across the red there, and the reason he's done that is he doesn't want to leave the red to the right of where the white and red is to the corner. So he must waste a shot here. And when you look at that, you've basically got red at the bottom of the table, stuck between a couple of yellows. You've got red and yellow near the right middle pocket. So a lot of dramas for Joel to deal with to pot out in one here. However, even after just playing the little runoff, he's still in absolute control of this frame, Gus, so...
I think he's going to try and control the left-hand corner, I reckon. Shortly.
Well, I think he'll just eliminate these two balls at the top and just keep himself refined to half a table. And it's a very common rule to keep yourself just to one half of the table. And I know if you are a frequent watcher of my commentary, you will know that I've just contradicted myself, because I made a comment a while ago saying it's not that bad a thing to leave a ball the other end of the table. And I learnt that from the great Mick Hill.
Oh, Mick Hill, who is here at the very moment. Yeah, he can play a bit, can't he?
He can. And if you're asking, if you didn't actually hear me make that comment, you're thinking that is a stupid comment. Why would you not just leave yourself to half a table? The reason for that is sometimes you can be playing a tricky sort of out and you might run out of position, and that ball that you leave at the other end of the table is kind of like a backup ball for you to reset yourself into position. So you play that, obviously you're running the wide a bit, but it gives you a chance to reset. Now, as I say, this big shot coming for you from Joel for the promotion of the red, and that is a great shot, but he's just kicked a yellow on the back of the red. Now, I reckon, Gus, he can punch this ball in the middle, come centre table. In fact, this is actually really tricky, because he wants to be pretty much where the black is, really, or just above it, and then he can basically play the red in off the side cushion, off the red. It basically moves the yellow away from the red, and then he's on his last red. I said that like it was just a piece of cake. Now, he's underhit this by probably 3 to 4 foot. And this shot now becomes tricky because he's now colliding into a yellow. And
I don't think he can do it now.
No, well, he can still play the shot, but he needs a lot of luck to land on his last red. Because of the traffic in play. And this is, and I think what Joel will do now is play the red, and he'll double kiss the other red that's near the pocket and just promote them both and just take full control of that pocket. So he'll be looking for just a double kiss on this red. Well, he's taken yellow first, which was a slightly safer option, but I'm sure that he wanted to just double kiss red first, not really hit the yellow at all.
I'll just say there is a massive gap now to that corner pocket, so if Mick can get to his yellows at the top end of the table, that yellow that's near the right-hand side pocket, he can put it down in the corner.
It does smash down there, doesn't it,
Gus? It certainly
and,
does.
And it's not one that you want to just glide in there. You actually really want to clear that pocket. You've got two reds you want completely not even in the same postcode as that pocket.
He's got a big pocket, so.
But obviously couldn't play that shot, and so he plays a containing. Don't be surprised here if Joel actually plays the yellow on the red and just covers up that hole you just spoke of.
Now these shots, many players can overhit him and drop the red and can go wrong.
Yeah, I think all I'd be doing here, Gus, is hitting bottom side of this yellow and pushing my red to the side cushion, block that hole off, give him two.
That's
exactly
shot.
What Joel has done. Well, has he left a gap there?
No, there's no gap there.
You're spot on. I got a bit excited for no reason at all. I did get excited then, didn't I?
You did. You definitely...
Can you tell I'm going for Mick as well there, Gus?
Oh, look, I love both, to be honest.
I think Mick deserves a result. Yeah. I really do. I love his game. I like the bloke. And
he wants it bad too, doesn't he? He's just...
I just like his fighting qualities. I tell you what, the way he's played, that I really do think he's going to punch this.
He just also he does stick to himself to an extent as well, and just here to get the job done.
I really do think he's going to play the punch out here.
There's definitely no gap, but if he can jam.
This actually, Mick made comment to me that he's had a couple of shots and he keeps giving them away back to his opponent, and this is another one of these shots that can actually go wrong if he plays it wrong. If he actually catches any of that red before the bottom red, before the top red, he will actually pot the bottom red. It'll be a, sort of like a double kiss fashion, and he'll pot the red. And this is why he's going to deny it, I'm pretty sure. Well, he's going to still play it. Yeah, what's he doing? I'm not sure what he's doing.
I've got no idea.
He's playing a double ball kick out. Wow, what a shot. And a good result, very good shot there from Michael Scarry.
So now he's state the obvious, he's going to look to go game here.
Nothing wrong with state the obvious there, Gus, because it's still a tricky out. You've got to play ultimately what you want when you're making an out. A little stun shots, a little roll-ins for transitional, just transition from ball to the next. You don't want to be punching balls in and screwing back half a table and doing all these fancy things if you don't have to. Now this ball that's up the top, he needs to eliminate that as soon as possible, and that's about what he's about to do right now. So now he can screw back down, he wants to go just past middle pocket. Maybe, you know, another foot past middle pocket and be pretty much on the rail, and then he can just screw that ball back a foot and then he's fat on his next yellow. So he's gone the right way about this to simplify it. Would have liked to have screwed back another foot there, but just
he's
obviously wanted to make sure we pot the ball primarily. Now this is the sort of shot you say to yourself, this is a good lesson that I learnt. Now there are two ways to look at this. You can either say, I don't want to underscrew this, or you can say, it doesn't matter if I overscrew this a foot. Now they are two different statements, but still mean very much the same thing. One is a negative way of saying it, and one is a positive way of saying it. Now, if you say it in the negative way, your mind very often will cause you to do it without you even realizing. So if you say here, oh, don't underscrew this, you will. Now, I wonder if that's what Mick's done there, because in my eyes, you don't want to underscrew that. If you screw back another foot, even 2 foot, it's much easier to come off the back cushion and get position. Now he's got to play a run through, and everything I've just said sucks because it goes out the window because this black goes in the corner. I didn't think it was on. But hopefully for the guys out there listening, understand the theory behind that. What I'm getting at is any comment you've got about making a positional shot, make it a positive thing rather than a negative thing, and your mindset will be better when you play the shot. Just to answer some of the comments on the feed, the chat feed as well. Danny, you'd like to see a money match between Robbo and Ben. I can pretty much guarantee that ain't going to happen in the near future. However, Robbo and Jake, in my opinion, needs to happen as soon as possible. There's so many people talking about that potential match and wanting it to happen. And I don't think it's too far away, so... But anyway, we have other big matches to worry about first. Another three or four of them, in fact, just for today. And then we have Anzac finals tomorrow, so pools galore for the next 2 days. And a big, big break from Joel. Balls absolutely everywhere. And if he can get through this yellow in the middle and just get a little nudge on the yellow on the side cushion, he will be favourite to go game. Well, he didn't have a good angle there, so he's just going to run it down the rail. Geez, that tugged the rail a couple of times and ducked out, but however you look at it, he's underhit it by some margin. And I think Mick might be able to get through to this red just inside ball from the left-hand side. Just need to get behind his shot if I can have a look. Well, I don't need to now because he's already sizing the shot up. And this tells us the story, and Mick has a very big chance here to take a lead. Well, he just checked that up off the rail and it really squared up heavy. And, well, not on a string, that particular shot. So we want to pop this red on the left-hand side down the rail. And just a smidge in the right-hand side certainly wouldn't help positional play, but denies that shot. Looks like he might have a perfect angle to place ball in the middle and just get a little nudge on the red. And that's beautifully controlled, and the reason I say it is because it's so easy to overhit those or underhit them where you just don't have a nice shot on the ball. Danny, can you just actually say what state you're from, because I've actually never seen you on the chat feed before, so. Just, there's a couple of people saying stop unhitting balls. just say you've got a bit of knowledge of these tables if you've just tuned in today. These Riley tables play very differently to a lot of the other tables that we're certainly used to in this state, and the cushions, they've been quite erratic in the way they react. Sometimes they'll completely kill the white, other times they'll bounce quite normally, and even on occasions you'll get a larger bounce, so they're a bit unpredictable, and it's caused positional play to be quite a nightmare at times. Well, how was that not? Oh, it has gone in. I was just going to say, how has that not gone in? The problem for Mick, though, was he's actually overcut the pot, and that's forced him to overrun the white and not get position.
I reckon he might tuck in a little.
Oh, we have a Tassie fan online. There you go.
No wonder why he wanted Riggy Lee.
Exactly right. I'm assuming Danny's a guy, not a girl. I'm just assuming that. But
Yeah, people want to see a money match with Rubbo and Ben, or yeah, Rubbo and Jake.
I've just touched on that, Gus, and actually, sorry, that Danny just asked why not Rubbo and Benny. Basically, Benny's taking a bit of a break from the practice scene at the moment, and then the whole money match scene thing. So I'm sure he'll return better than ever, because in my opinion, he is the pinnacle of money matches and big occasion play. But at the moment, Benny will probably take a bit of a back seat and just let the other guys have a crack at each other for a bit.
Now, do you think Jake will have to? Do you think he'll go through everyone else like Rubbo has, and then get to Rubbo at the end?
It's an interesting statement, Gus, because Rubbo said, yep, why should I just go and play Jake straight up? He should have to go through all the people I've gone through before we play. Now, that's not going to happen.
No.
Simple as that, it just won't happen.
And why is that, though? Why?
Well, interstate players, they've got to meet up at some stage. There's not that many tournaments coming up that are close. The next tournament's Berry in July. We have quite a few months between then. Those two just need to put the cash on the table and just get it happening.
Yep.
Simple as that. Now, Robbo's next hit list opponent is actually Rusty Wheeler, who just wrecked him in his tournament. That certainly won't worry Robbo's mindset, because they won't play on these Raleigh tables that Rubbo hates, and Rusty loves them. And I can tell you the reason for that is because Rusty's style... I'll tell you what these tables suit players, what sort of player. These sort of tables suit players that play position in areas. And when I say areas, I mean there could be a 2-foot area of table you're landing on. And guys like Robbo are precision players. They like to land in 10-cent coins. These tables, because of the erratic reactions of the cushions, make that extremely difficult to do.
Funny you say that. Kurt Dunham, he loves these tables because he reckons they're like a mini snooker table, and he's one of those players that has to get on that 10-cent piece.
Well, I disagree with that, Gus, because he plays a lot of very big shots, and he plays in areas as well, and he attacks the game 100%. And I think the other thing is you need to actually attack the balls on these tables, and Robbo, the way he's been winning a lot of his matches, yes, he's been running heaps of racks and he's been dishing up people's mistakes, but he also has been throwing in that slower tactical game as well and mixing it right up, because he actually does have a very strong tactical game. So I think that match that he played against Rusty, and also he was very angry in that match as well. A few things happened off the table that he wasn't happy about, and he didn't go in with a very good mindset, which was, I think, to his discredit, very unprofessional, and also unfortunate as well. So he'll learn from that, and it certainly won't worry him if he does get to play Rusty again for $1,000. But the problem is location, location, location. Rusty's in Queensland, and Robbo's in Victoria. So anyway, so just to shut up about all this crap. Jake, Robbo, hurry the hell up and play each other.
Yeah, that is going to be an absolute corker. But Jake has only played the one money match, so do you think that will come into effect?
Well, I'm the one that's been setting up these matches for Jake, and I told Jake that he wasn't ready for Robbo a while ago. I said he needed to get some more money matches under his belt. Now, obviously, he played Mick, and he belted him 11-2 or 11-1 or whatever it was, and Mick basically turned around and said, look, I'll play him again. He's already ready to play. Now, Mick's obviously having a great tournament right here. It wouldn't surprise me if Mick rang me up next week and said, you know what, I'm ready to play Jake again.
Well, he said he was ready to play Jake a night after he lost 11-1.
Yeah, and that's what Mick's like. He has a lot of pride, and he wants to play the best and back himself at all times. Money to him, it's not about the money for Mick. It's about the pride, the prestige. So, and he wants to test himself against the best.
I don't know if that yellow will go the middle. I don't think it's come far enough.
Oh, it definitely won't. And there was a big attacking shot there from Joel, and well, it hasn't paid off. Now, one shot he has here, and it's a pretty aggressive shot, is to punch this yellow in, stun off a side cush with right hand side, and come past. Just pass to probably equal with the centre pocket, and then play a double on the yellow. Well, he's gone for corner instead, which is not stupid either. He gets it actually back. He's queuing down the rail instead. He's starting to hit it a touch. And he may need to use some right-hand side of this to avoid snooking himself on the red. So when you're using side, a lot of people actually play these shots with side. They believe it helps it hug the ball down the rail. And that is a good shot, but no side used, and would have snooked himself if he got the pot. Mark McDonald, I don't know where you're from, but you are obviously acting like an absolute imbecile being a keyboard warrior. You just need to calm down, fella. I don't know how you can hang shit on a bloke that's doing commentating when he's got the microphone and you've just got a keyboard to type on. You are an idiot.
Yeah, not too sure who you are, Mark. You
tell me what, you've got to be from New South Wales, surely.
Come down and have a go.
I'm
going
to have to pull out Jim Jeffries on this bloke soon.
What does monotone mean? Oh, I don't even know what it means.
Monotone, it means the same tone all the time, which I'm actually very shocked that he's called me monotone, given that I probably have more tone than any commentator that does this stuff, so...
Might have called me that, though, isn't it?
Quite offending.
I think he called me that, actually.
Well, maybe he did, I don't know, Gus, but... Either way, it's out of line, because he's not here and he's not having a crack at doing what you're doing.
Well, Mick's left a gap there.
He has, and Joe will have a... Yeah, Joe will probably take this
frame for
sure.
Gary waved his cue in frustration.
Yeah, you're right, Gus. That's definitely on. And I'll tell you, Gus, even if he gets that pot, he's still got a couple of big shots to play. And Joel is underhit that by a foot. Now, you and I know he's underhit it straight away. And for the viewers at home that are wondering why, you know, oh, yeah, he can still pot it, yeah, for sure. But when you're on a shot like this where you've only got half a pocket where you've got to sort of jam a ball inside, you want to actually be right behind the shot. You don't want any angle at all. You want to be able to hit this dead straight into the jaw off the red. This just makes the shot so much harder when you're hitting it with a bit of angle.
This can easily just double kiss and...
Exactly. If you catch the red first here, it's bye-bye red. Joel has... Oh, where's that white? Oh, that was close.
Solid, and, you've got to use your inside voice, mate. And your Isle of Man.
Do not even know what this clown's talking about. What's actually really funny is you're typing on a keyboard and other people are reading what you're typing while they listen to me commentate.
Look, mate, you can simply put it on mute.
And all these guys know you're an idiot.
Just press the mute button and you know to listen to us. Anyway, 9-8, Joel.
9-8 to Joel and, well... He's actually, full credit to Mick, because he's been, as we said earlier, Joel's been creeping away from guys when their score's been close earlier on in the matches, but Mick's managed to stay with him. And yellows will be the choice. And the only reason I say that is because I think he's got an easy starter.
Thank you, Shelley. We love you. You should be here playing. Just fees here, so why aren't you here, Shelly?
I think that's Shell, actually, mate.
Yeah, Shelly Grundy from Tassie.
Oh, you know it. That's good. Yep. Actually, I do too. What am I talking about?
You do.
So Mick's just sizing this up because, well, it's getting to the point in the match where it's no more mistake time. Takes the reds.
Yes, we're just guessing that red passes to the right-hand corner, the one that's wedged with the yellow.
Now this ball over the middle, I'm actually right behind this. It's off the cushion by probably between a quarter and a half inch. Sorry, I can't fractionalise that any better. I just tried to simplify it as much as I could. But it definitely goes. And I'm actually not surprised at all that miss, because there's just no lip on these middles at all. They're very tough. And what you'll find is they do just travel across the lip, hit the jaw and don't drop. Yep. Whereas if you look at the tables at the back there, they've got a far bigger lip and much, they're basically like buckets compared to these middle pockets. And yeah, no surprise to see that ball miss at all. A very tough shot. Oh wow, he's pulled out a three-syllable word on me.
So Joel is going to look to grind this out and take himself to a 10-8 lead on the hill.
Marky McDonald, can you tell me what state you're from, please? I'd love it to be from Victoria.
He seems to know about his pool, so he should come down and...
Well, I don't know why he's not here playing the comps. But anyway, back to the game. Joel's working through these. Now, he's playing in such a way where maybe the yellow goes off the red in the centre. And I've just had a quick look at the table itself. To me, it doesn't look like it does that at all. So this out, at face value, Gus, doesn't look easy at all. So Joel actually has a very good angle here to go into the yellow and red that are stuck to one another. The problem with his shot is though, is guaranteeing position on the ball, and there's a lot of transitional play from one end of the table to the other required, which with some very difficult pots and positional play, so hard out coming up.
Archfield Ando giving us a wrap.
Good to see the Sarge online. There's a lot of Tasmanian presence actually online
here.
Good
to see.
Would like to have seen a few more Tassie guys over in playing in the comp actually. We had a few last year and obviously Ali's made the trek and Rudders as well. But
knocked off Ron Kelly, the Australian titles.
Did.
Troy Rudley.
We didn't get a huge Tassie presence this year, and I tell you what, I actually really rate the Tasmanian 8-ball circuit. When they actually put their best state side in, they are a force. And a bit of young talent coming out of there as well, in Cale Barrett.
Yep.
Big rap for the Tassie guys. And the main reason I am is a great bunch of blokes. Good to have a drink with and have a social. I think they really enjoy it when they make the trip to Australia.
Well, technically they are overseas, aren't they?
Sorry, guys. Sorry, guys, I had to put that in.
Trent Reinheimer wants to see a match with Rubbo and Travis Crawley.
That's never going to happen. Travis will never play the match. It was 11-2. It's 11-2, Dan. He got wrecked. I can promise you now that Travis Crawley will never play Robbo for 1,000.
Yeah, no love lost there.
Big shot coming up here in the context of this match. This to go to the hill right here, Gus. This is effectively the black.
Oh, well, there's a queuing of Joel Younger.
And I'm telling you right now, Gus, this is why this guy is still, in my eyes, one of the favourites to win the tour. I know Russ's got a double chance, but that is a freak show
shot. People won't know exactly how hard that shot was on these tables.
Exactly, that is a tough shot. He goes on the hill and Mick actually taps the table in appreciation of that shot, but also filthed about it because he knows he's just lost that frame and he goes, he cannot afford any more mistakes.
That was nothing but net.
It was a super shot, no doubt about it. Nothing but great queuing, and Joel will also break for the match. And I'll tell you what, I've seen a lot of people get on the hill and break and clear as well during this tournament.
They keep saying Joel keeps under hitting the balls. Yes, Shelly, the girls are locked at 3-all, I think. Linda, Element, Rhiannon, Bolt for the best female.
I don't understand this don't under-hit comment. It's Joel's actually playing pretty good. He's not playing at his best, but he's definitely playing. And for those that actually don't know, Joel's won this the last 2 years, and he actually put in a bit of time. I've been informed that he actually hasn't put in near the amount of time that he's put in previous years for this comp, for various reasons. And for him to still be here just actually shows what a class act he is, because I actually still think he is one of the best players in the country.
I think he's top three, for sure.
The unfortunate part is he never gets named in it by your general public, because a lot of them will look at national titles feed, who wants the Australian Championship, etc, etc. Now Joel just doesn't play in these, and you're wondering why he doesn't? He's a businessman, simple as that. And in actual fact, we have a thing in the regional Victoria called the Country Cup, and basically we all get together and play a big pool comp, and it was at Joel's pool lounge this year, and I had a few sherbets, and I got stuck right into him, and I said, you have to make a stateside, and you've got to represent Victoria just one time. And I didn't let it go either. He goes, come on, Jamie, just go easy, mate, give me a break. I said, no, Joel, I'm not going to let this go until you do it.
Well, I reckon if we get him on the sauce, he will, because he is one of the funniest people on the sauce I've ever seen.
He's pretty funny when he's had a few drinks. Doesn't mind getting naked either, just quietly.
Him on the sauce is an absolute loose cannon.
He is. But anyway, I would actually love to say, anyway, while we've actually been, I've talked a bunch of rubbish, Mick's just really rushed through these balls quickly. At 10-8 down, he said, you know what, Joel, screw your 10-8.
Mick's scary.
I'm going to make it 10-9.
He's got a massive heart.
So, he's just deciding which ball to pot.
The score is 10-8 to Joel Younger.
Yeah, the reason you can't see the 10 is that particular score sheet doesn't have a 10, it just stops at 9, so he just flicked it over to a nothing. But obviously, if you've been watching a while, you'll know that's the case. Nice shot there from Mick, and he will go 10-9.
As Mark McDonald would say, he's under hit that.
Well, he has, but he'll still be okay.
Yeah, there it is.
And, Mark, you still haven't told me what state you're from yet, but some of your comments sort of suggest to me perhaps you're a snooker player as well, because...
I don't think Mark McDonald's his real name, to be honest. I think he's a well-known bull buyer.
Don't know, but a lot of snooker players will get on here and suggest similar things to under-hitting balls and not attacking, whatever. Obviously, have a lot bigger area to move. And I do like to hear some of the snooker player comments in regards to two-shot pulls when they're constructive. And the reason I say that is because it's so easy for a snooker player to transition from snooker to eight ball once they learn the tactics, because they already have a very good foundation with their cueing action. Whereas for an eight ball player to transition to snooker, it's far more difficult.
Yep.
And obviously that's why snooker's the greatest game in the world.
Certainly is.
But I suck at the game, so I play eight ball.
Well, I'm sure if you put some time in, Jamie, I'm sure you'd be solid.
Certainly would be no Sean Budd, let's put it that way. But I love the game of 8-ball, and I'll continue to play it for as long as I can walk.
Who is part-time cuist?
I'm not a bad guess, am I, mate? I think part-time cuist might be Shane Lee, yes. But anyway, Marky, you haven't told us what state you're from yet. I'm guessing New South Wales.
Yeah, he doesn't want to say. So we'll take that as New South. Joel looking to clinch the match here on yellows.
These three yellows on the left here, it's just a bit tricky. Obviously the top one goes to the middle, but then he's still got to deal with the other two. Obviously one's hampering the other. The plant is not set.
Scary's just raised his eyebrow at me.
Yeah, Scary I think might be sensing that there's a potential chance he may not get back to the table. But so Joel's got a shot in the middle here to just bump the second of the two yellows. But he could lose the white here because it looks like it's going to hit a bit thin. Well, he did it full ball, but he did lose the white as I suggested he might. In actual fact, it didn't really matter what sort of angle he hit that at. He was always never going to be in prime position. But he still does have a shot, and that is all that matters to Joel.
Mark McDonald reckons it's better queuing new Nance needed here. And he's from New South Wales. You hit the nail on the head, Solid.
Well, I've been doing this gig for a while now, and I can sort of pick it. But, Marky, I really do think you should come and play a few 8-ball tournaments, mate, and you'll find out this game's not as easy as it looks.
So this has become an even trickier out.
This out just doesn't look gettable to me anymore unless he plays a massive chop down the bottom rail here.
And just try and cut this yellow bottom left-hand corner and bump into those wall of reds.
If he does get his shot, Gus, then yes, that's obviously he will probably win the frame. But the reason I say that is I just haven't seen many of these balls go. These are tough. And not only that, he can't play it naturally. He's just going to can into the red. It's just above it. So he's actually got to play it, use a little bit of side or bottom or whatever. But bottom's not going to help him too much because the angle's pretty thin. So he's actually got to use some side as well. Well, he's used heaps of side, but as I suggested, he's missed the pot.
Never looked like going in.
Well, they're tough. That's what I'm saying. They're tough. Yeah. He's actually used an enormous amount of side there, but obviously it's costing the pot. However, he's in a pretty good spot at the moment.
Still
anyway.
Tricky out on reds.
And obviously, we have forgotten the component of, you know, you don't actually have to pot out, but you know, obviously that's the aim of the game. Mick could actually play a clever little snooker here as well. But I don't know, if I'm Mick, I'm still having a dip here. He's 10-8 down. Throw caution to the wind and have a crack. In that ball game. Oh, it's just gone.
Well, so Mick's definitely going to have a crack here.
Yeah, so stunned for the ball on the bottom rail. He doesn't want to be right behind. He wants a little bit of angle. And then he can just float up the table. Yeah, when I say float up the table, you can't just randomly land anywhere because that yellow's actually, when you look at it, it's basically obstructing anything flowing from the right-hand side to the left-hand side of the table at this bottom end. So it's really only the one ball, but that one ball is actually very important. So he does have his ball in the middle. Now, if he's actually got an angle here to get on the ball in the bottom cushion first, that would be great for him. But he doesn't, and he's decided to transition top end of the table now. And, well, that's actually worked out nicely.
It's pretty good, I reckon. Dave Rothen wants to know if the pockets are the same size as last year. I think they are.
Yeah, Dave, mate, to be honest, I think they're pretty much spot on. I just think the rails are just a little bit more trickier than what they were last year. Just a little bit. They're very much similar tables, though. And I actually got Kurt Dunham. I challenged Kurt Dunham earlier on in the day to punch a ball down the rail when the ball was touching the rail. And he couldn't do it.
That's a bad miss.
I think that's it, Jamie.
Could be.
I think that's
a still
match
a
right
big,
there.
Still a very good positional shot required. Now, Joel, what he'll be doing here is he'll be trying to play this shot. He'll either screw back and go past centre pocket to the ball climb, where he's pretty much pointing his cue right now, or he'll use side cushion to go back down. I personally think he'll trust his cueing action, and he'll screw directly back down.
I think he gets anywhere past centre, it's game, mate.
Well, actually, he's actually lying. He's using the cushion. Used the cushion, and he has landed perfectly.
Hello, Wayne Stubbs. Oh, yeah, mate, played this last year, you actually knocked me
out. Wayne Stubbs, very glad you're not here this year, mate, since you knocked me out last year.
Oh, he knocked me out too. Jamie, he actually beat me as well, 11-9, in the early morning, early hours of Saturday morning.
Well, the rail. Did you see that, Gus? The rail has killed the wide a touch.
They have screwed everyone over this weekend.
They have. They just killed him a touch. And I tell you what, everybody knows it's happening, but when you're playing a flowing game and you just expect things to happen like you used to, it's so hard to adjust your mindset to just give it a bit more. And
they are as dead as doormats, these rails.
Well, the thing is, like I said, they're inconsistent because one minute you'll get a big bounce, the next minute you don't, the next minute they come off normal. So they're providing a real positional nightmare to the players. I still think Joel will get this. And
he's going in the centre, Jamie.
This surprises me.
I thought he'd be going.
Well, it's made just it. Held, but ooh, this is tricky as well. He's sort of landed no man's land here.
Oh, look. In the corner, I think Joel, he's potting his.
Yeah, I definitely think he'll play this corner, Gus. He'll be just stunning off it. And however, I'm really surprised he didn't play that last ball to the corner, but I think he felt he could soft screw it in and hold it a bit better than he has, but he's still okay.
He's going in the middle.
Wow. Well, he loves the middle pockets,
well,
apparently.
There you go. It is.
Jeez, he runs over there like a bowler on the bowling green.
I'll tell you what, he ran over there quicker than Usain Bolt.
And Joel continues to stay alive in this tournament and be a very dangerous factor.
The defending two-time in a row champ is still in.
Mick Scarry, hold your head high. You've had a pretty good tournament, and you've lost to one of the world's, one of Australia's best.
The ladies are—they're at 4-3. Now, solid. Are we going to switch over the ladies or
no? We have another match coming straight on. That's why we're not going to do it. We may, well, there may be a 10-minute break, so Joel can just obviously refresh himself, but it'll be Alec and Joel next. So now, we'll be back shortly with another cracker match, guys. Stay tuned, and
we are full throttle going for Joel.
Well, Rusty's actually tucked in bed asleep at the moment. He knew that he'd have at least a 6-hour wait after he won his double chance match. So last year, one of the years that he got runner up, he waited like 6 or 7 hours before he played, and he just said he was stuffed. So he's gone. And
so now people will, this match will play the rake, pigeon.